You know, the great thing about technology is our ability to get things done quicker than ever. Let me ask you a question. When was the last time that you mailed a handwritten letter? When was the last time that you wrote a handwritten letter? You see, there's no need today to wait three or four days to send a letter in the mail and wait 3 or 4 days for a response from the person to whom we sent it. We have email today. We have the technology to send something in a matter of seconds, to receive a response in a matter of seconds. So with the technology and the expediency that we have, we really have the ability to do things extremely quick. When you think about distractions and things that can get in the way, sometimes that technology that enables us to do things quickly, sending emails or working on projects on our computers or even our smartphones, allow us to do things quicker, but they also can distract us. Say you're in the middle of a project on your computer and you get a message that pops up from your spouse asking you to pick up something on the way home from the store. Or a message pops up on your computer that someone likes something that you posted on Facebook, so what do? You check the message on Facebook. You want to see how many likes you got or if somebody responded to it. Or perhaps you're in the middle of that same project on the computer and someone sends you 3 or 4 text messages to which you check your phone and then you need to reply, and maybe that turns into a conversation or someone actually calls your phone and you have to talk on the phone. There's so many distractions out there that can get in the way of our everyday lives. And we understand that because of the society in which we live today. We know that's the case, but we also have to remember that sometimes those same distractions with technology can also get in the way of our spiritual lives. Technology is distracting. One of the devil's greatest tools is distracting people and pulling their attention away from God. Satan wants us to embrace the world and all of its wickedness. So if that means Satan can use the same technology that we use to be productive and to do our jobs and to communicate every day, it's the same tools that he can also use to pull our attention away from focusing on what we need to do. Satan will even use things that might seem beneficial to us, such as work or school or hobbies, things that will pull us away from God. And maybe that distraction is only for a moment, but what may seem momentarily can turn into a lifetime if we're not careful. When we no longer have our focus and attention on God and what God has set before us, then we can easily lose our way and we can become distracted. So what we have to do then is we have to disconnect. Pray you guys are all doing well. Pray your family is staying safe. Lord willing, we're going to get past this mess and that we'll be back together soon. I know I keep saying that, but all we can do is continue to pray for that effort. Pray for our elders as they're doing the best they can. And more importantly, pray for them because they have to make these tough decisions. They want us to be back together, but they also want to make sure that we're safe, especially with what we're going through in our society right now. Let's start with a word of prayer and then we'll get into our Bible class. Our Father in heaven, we thank you and love you for the blessings that you give us every day. We thank you for this opportunity now to open up your word, to study from it. Father, help us to put away the distractions in life. Help us to focus on you during this time. Help us to focus on your word and help us to better understand those things that can pull us away and distract us from what you have us or what you would have us to do. Father, we thank you for loving us. We thank you for giving us your word by which we can learn and grow and those things that we can study to learn how to be better today than we were yesterday. Father, we continue to lift up our congregation during this time. We pray for this virus. We pray for those who have been affected by the virus, rather. We pray for those who are fighting the virus, and we pray for soon relief and in a vaccine that might enable us to be back to a portion of normalcy. Father, we continue to pray for the safety of our congregation. We pray for those who might be affected by this virus, those who might be affected financially, whatever the case is. Father, we know that you know their needs and their wants and their desires, and we pray that you'll continue to bless them and comfort them and guide them as you always do. Father, we continue to lift up our leadership to watch over our elders. We thank you for their willingness to serve, but more importantly, their love for us and their willingness to look out for our best interests because they love us and they love our soul. Father, pray for their families. We pray for our deacons, for the works that continue to go on. We pray for us as a family here at Cary and that you'll continue to walk with us and bless us as you always do. Watch over those who are hurting and who are sick at this time, those who are struggling with their faith or something emotionally. pray that you'll be with them and continue to comfort them. Father, help us to continue to reach out to each other, to love one another, but more importantly, that we show the world who Jesus is through our actions and through our speech. Father, forgive us when we fail you. We know we fall short. It's in Jesus' name we do humbly pray. Amen. When you think about the distractions out there, those things that can pull us away, it's easy to find biblical examples of distractions in the Bible. And I'm sure one that we know very well is that of the case of Martha. You remember when Martha was distracted in what we read in Luke chapter 10, verses 38 through 42. And now it happened as they went that he entered a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, who also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was distracted with much serving. Notice it said that she was distracted with much serving. And she approached him and said, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Therefore, tell her to help me." And Jesus answered and said to her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and troubled about many things, but one thing is needed, and Mary has chosen that good part which will not be taken away from her." You have to remember, it wasn't that Martha was doing anything wrong or that she was doing something that was bad. Nevertheless, it said, and what Jesus records for us here, is that Martha was distracted with much serving. When Martha complained to Jesus, what did Jesus respond with? "One thing is needed." Well, what is that one thing? Jesus didn't come right out and state that the one thing that was obvious was that she needed to be listening to Jesus Christ. She needed Jesus. Most, if not all, the things that we have in our lives concerning technology and all of the things that can distract us in and of themselves are not wrong. Family and friends are not bad. Hobbies are not bad. Our jobs are not bad because they enable us to continue to serve the Lord and to give back to Him that which He so richly blessed us with. But it comes down to what is most important and what is our priorities. Have you ever walked into a living room as a parent and your kids are watching television, and after you've already called their names three or four times from another room because you need them to come bring you something or do something, only to walk into the living room and find them basically in this zombie-like trance as they're watching cartoons or watching TV? You find your kids mindlessly doing nothing. You see, this is a distraction. They're not paying attention. They're not listening to what you're telling them to do. This is the reaction that the devil wants from us in relation to when God is telling us what he wants from us. He wants us to respond to God as if we've never heard what he said. And so we can be distracted, but the one thing that we need is Jesus. That's where our focus needs to be. So let's make this practical then. If you think about Jesus, and rather the Bible tells us in Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 2 to pay attention to the cross, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is now set down on the right hand of the throne of God. So what the Bible is telling us there and what the Hebrew writers were relaying to the Hebrew Christians is, look to Jesus as the author and finisher of our faith. We have to pay attention to him. So again, we always want to take God's word. When we think about what it means to be distracted and what we must do to disconnect when those distractions pull our attention away from God, let's put it into practical terms then. How distractions can affect us today? Well, obviously they can pull our attention and make us lose focus. They can pull our attention away and they can make us lose focus on God. So I Googled this statistic, all right? It's actually quite funny, but sad at the same time when you think about it, because it's talking about us. According to a study by Microsoft, and this popped up when I Googled the attention span of human being, according to a study by Microsoft, the average human being now has an attention span of 8 seconds. This is a decrease from the average attention span of 12 seconds back in the year 2000. Think about that for just a second. 8 seconds. I can tell you it's easy to become distracted when you sit down and you try and write a class or a sermon, when you get text or people are calling, and none of those things are bad, but it takes discipline, really, when you think about it, concerning our focus and what we need to be paying attention to. And we've all been there. I've been there. You've been there. It's easy for us to focus on something, but something so small and minute as a text message or an email or somebody posting to our social media account, drawing our attention away from what we need to focus on. Think about that. 8 seconds. Our cell phones have done a great job of destroying our ability to focus, haven't they? Your phone is a gateway to games and social media and news and communication, and the list goes on and on and on. A phone call or a text is enough to derail any task. So let me ask you this. How many times have you checked your phone during this Bible class so far? And if you're honest with yourself, you've probably checked it at least once. Maybe even you're pulling up the verses as we've looked at them so far in Luke 10, but you also maybe switched over real quick to a social media account or checked that email really fast. That's the devil getting in the way. The devil is distracting us from what our attention needs to be focused on and those things that pull us away. How many times have you been in the middle of a live conversation? Maybe you're eating lunch with a friend or something like that, and you get a text, and what do? You stop and check the text messages. So you're stopping. It's really rude when you think about it, but I'm sure we've all done that. Our lack of focus extends beyond tasks and activities as well. Our lack of focus and numerous distractions can begin, as we've been talking about, can begin to affect and distract us from our spiritual purpose for serving God. Look what Paul says in Philippians 4:8. Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue and if there is anything praiseworthy, it says to meditate, or perhaps your particular version says to think on these things. Pay attention to these things. Paul tells us there are things on which we should be dwelling, on which we should be focusing. The problem is sometimes we have trouble, right, dwelling on those things, dwelling on spiritual things, because we can't dwell on anything for that long, and apparently 8 seconds is about the maximum amount of time that we can focus on something. It might be the case, unfortunately, that some folks are just simply bored with the Word of God. They've allowed themselves to seek after things in their lives that they deem to be more important. It may seem like that big deal, or it may not seem rather like a big deal to become distracted while we're sitting through a Bible class. However, over time, it becomes a part of our character. And so when we're sitting in Bible class, looking at text messages or checking our social media feeds, or if somebody's responded to something that I posted, whatever the case is, if that becomes more important than me sitting through a 30 or 40 minute Bible class, it means that I need to disconnect. I've been asked before, and I always think it's funny, and I think people ask this because they really want to know, and they say, Larry, what can you see from the pulpit when you're preaching? What do you see when you're preaching out there, when you're looking at everybody, when you're looking at folks? And my answer is everything. First, I'm elevated, obviously, being on the platform of the pulpit stage, I can see. And then on top of that, I'm 6'7", so you add to that, I can see just about anything and everything that people are doing in their pews. Now, let me say this. I'm not looking for things. I'm not wondering if sister so-and-so or brother so-and-so is on their social media accounts or if they're texting someone, because a lot of people use their devices for their Bible, and there's nothing wrong with that. It's a great tool to have because we have notes and access to lexicons and all of those things, but here's the thing. Usually I can tell if somebody's on a social media feed because they're doing the social media scroll, right? You can see that motion as they're scrolling through Facebook or Instagram. You see, I can see when people are distracted because of the babies in front of them and they're making the goo-goo sweet faces at the babies. To me, it's absolutely hilarious, as if they don't think that I can see those things and the faces they're making. Believe it or not, those things don't really distract me, though. Not to say they never have, but I notice those. But when I'm preaching, I focus on what I'm preaching because I have to keep my attention on what I need to say. And that's come with practice over time. It hasn't always been easy. People have asked me, how can you preach with 3 or 4 babies that are crying and making a commotion? Well, that takes practice. And now it doesn't bother me, and half the time I don't even notice. But I also appreciate the fact that parents are trying to teach their children how to sit through these worship services. But I can see when people are fidgeting with something. Yes, it's easy to become distracted, because when you're sitting in a room with 300 or 400 people through a worship service, it's easy for something to catch our attention. But it comes down to this idea of practice and discipline of not allowing things to distract us from the moment in which we need to be paying attention to God, especially if we're communing together and we're partaking the Lord's Supper. We need to focus on the cross of Calvary at that moment. God isn't asking much time of us, if you think about it, and in the terms of how we serve Him and how we worship Him, but there are times in which we need to push the worldly distractions away, as you hear many men pray, to push those distractions out of our minds and fully focus on the cross of Calvary. This is important for us to be focused in these small areas of our Christian life so we can be better focused in our walk with God. We also have to remember what our priorities are. Priority is anything that is regarded as more important. That's just a basic definition. But when other things besides God become our number one priority, then God tends to really, in many cases, take the back seat. We can do this with our jobs when we're climbing the corporate ladder. We can do this if we're pursuing education and maybe it's a graduate degree or a PhD or a certain certificate for your job. We can do this because we allow those things to take priority over God. I've seen parents do this with their children when it comes to sports and travel ball. I've seen parents allow their children to miss church or Bible class on a Wednesday night for a baseball tournament or because they have a big test the next day. My question is, one, what is an hour out of their schedule? But two, what are we teaching our children concerning priorities when we come to church but they stay home and we say, well, you know what, that's more important? We're teaching and giving our children the wrong message. What are we teaching our children about priorities? Nothing. But Jesus tells us, right, to seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things are added unto us. Jesus didn't say to seek first His kingdom when you have time or when it's of convenience, or seek first also my kingdom in addition to these other things like travel ball or degrees or jobs, careers, whatever. Jesus said, but seek first. We can make that first a capital, we can put first in all caps there, but seek first. That's the important thing. We're called to seek God first and foremost before anything else. Because of technology, trivial things have become priorities. Do you know there are actually addictions out there to social media? Yeah, people can spend so much time being distracted by social media and spend countless hours on social media because they're more concerned with what everybody else is doing rather than focusing that time and putting their attention towards God. The problem is that when we make something else other than God our priorities, then we can begin to lose commitment. As God becomes of secondary importance to us, we begin to lose our commitment to Him altogether. Many of us attempt to have more than one priority. Think about what Jesus writes in Matthew 6:24. No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. Now, we know here Jesus is talking about wealth, but the principle remains true in all situations. We cannot choose to be devoted to both. Let's say it's pursuing a career because of wealth, at the same time seeking after God. You cannot stay fully committed to both. What does he say? You can't serve two things because either you're going to hate the one or love the other. Luke 10 and verse 27, Jesus said, so he answered and said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. God wants our full and undivided attention. Think about that verse again. Jesus is saying, you're going to love God and you're going to be committed. God's going to be your priority and He's going to be your number one focus. You're going to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind, even as your neighbor, even in your neighbor as yourself. You're going to love them and or love God completely. God wants us to make Him our priority. And so the question we have to ask ourselves is, do you find yourself or do we find ourselves easily distracted by the internet when we're trying to get work done? Do we think about, oh, I forgot I wanted to look that up because I've done that. Oh, I forgot I needed to check this, or I need to put this into my notes to make sure that I don't forget it later. And we deviate and we get sidetracked or we sidestep around what we need to do. Do you find yourself checking your phone when you should be engaged in a conversation? Do you find yourself trolling social media when you should be paying attention in Bible class? Do you find yourself being distracted by good things like Martha that keeps you from paying attention to the one thing, that's Jesus Christ, which is necessary to save our souls. It might be time, if we're finding all of these things as distractions, to step away from those things and to focus more on God. Maybe it's time, if all of these things are distracting us, maybe it's time to disconnect. Maybe it's time to refocus our attention on God and make Him our priority. Maybe next time you're studying your Bible, or that you're sitting through Bible class, and that phone is becoming a distraction because of all the other apps on your device, maybe it's time to bring in the good old hard copy of the Bible, or pull one out from the pew, or to bring your copy from home, because you don't want that to be a distraction for you. Or when you're sitting down at home studying the Bible, put those things in another room so they don't distract you for the 20 or 30 minutes that you want to devote to studying God's Word. Brethren, we've got to be more devoted and more focused on our Father in heaven. All of us fall short in this area. That includes me. Even as the preacher, sometimes I allow these things to distract me from my focus and my priority and my commitment to God. And so when we find those things, we have to really kind of give ourselves a gut check, so to speak, and say, you know what? It's time to disconnect. I can't allow these things to pull me away from my focus, and that's Jesus Christ. It's the same thing we need to teach our children, because our children, in many cases, if you think about it, our kids today have no idea what it's like to grow up without the internet, or to grow up without a cell phone, or to grow up without 250 channels and Netflix and Hulu and Amazon Prime and all of these other things we have to entertain us that will pull our attention away and our commitment to God. And so we've got to be that example to our children. We can't allow outside commitments to take away the priority of serving God or coming to Bible class or coming to worship because we want them to have a good career or we want them to be on that particular team. But here's the thing. They might be on that team and have that career on this side of eternity, but where are they going to be on the other side of eternity? And we want them to be with God. We want to be with God. So again, focus that priority on God. Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, as God is telling us in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 33. Make sure that we're making God the number one priority and not trying to serve two masters, again, as Jesus addresses in Matthew 6, 24, and put God first in our lives. And when we do that, we're going to be richly blessed in the sense that we understand what our focus should be and what we need to continue to pay attention to. So I pray that that helps. I pray that's something that you'll work on. As always, with all of these things we've focused on over the course of this study and what it means to disconnect from technology and things that can cause us to go astray from God and His Word, those are things we need to practice and put into our daily lives to continue to work on. So I pray that you're doing those things I'm trying to incorporate as well to make sure that I'm not distracted and the many other things that we discuss. So continue to work on those things. As always, if you have any questions, please reach out to me or to us here at the Cary Church of Christ. You can find all of our information on our website at carycoc.org, or you can email me directly at minister@carycoc.org, and I'd be happy to answer any questions. If you want to know about your salvation and what condition you're in, simply go to God's Word. He tells us what we must do to be saved, to repent, to hear, believe, repent, confess, and be baptized. Repentance means we're willing to put away our past. Luke 13:3, that we're willing to confess Jesus as the Son of God, Matthew 10:32, and have our sins washed away in baptism, Acts 2:38. If you know that you're outside of Christ, but you have questions on what to do to get into Christ, to be added to the Lord's church, Acts 2:47, again, reach out to us. We want to help you. And if you're struggling as a Christian, as always, pray to God. Have a serious conversation with Him. Ask God for strength and wisdom, patience, guidance, courage, that you might get through these times. But if you're still struggling, I encourage you to always reach out to our elders, to reach out to myself, that we might walk with you through this problem or struggle that you're facing, or to reach out to someone that you trust or love in the congregation that's a dear brother or sister in Christ. As always, shine your light, show the world who you are. Pray that you have a blessed week. Take care. God bless.